Hello and welcome to eOptions webinar, and we're excited to have you here. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to join us. We partnered with Teddy Kekstad, a professional trader with over 30 years of experience, to bring you this webinar on protecting your stock positions in a bear market. My name is Gina Bokaias, and I'm with eOption. And just to provide you with some basic information on logistics for the webinar today, the session will last approximately 1 hour. If you have any questions at all during the webinar presentation, please feel free to type them into the question box, and our speaker will answer those at the end of his presentation. Also, you can reach out to eOptions Trade Desk at any time if you have additional questions after the webinar. And for those of you just joining, we'd like to welcome you to eOptions webinar on protecting your stock positions in a bear market. Now, I'd like to turn our attention to our speaker now, Teddy Kekstad. We're excited to have him speak today, and he's a seasoned professional trader, and he's ready to share his insights and his trading strategies with you. Teddy has over 30 years of trading and industry experience, and to tell you a little bit about his background, he traded on several trading floors in Chicago, including the Chicago Board Options Exchange, the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, and the Chicago Board of Trade for 21 years. He's also been an institutional market analyst for 25 plus years, and he currently serves as president of Forex Trading Unlocked. And he's also the author of a trading educational book called High Probable Japanese Candlestick Patterns. He also has a degree in finance from DePaul University. And so without further ado, I'll turn it over to Teddy Kekstad. Thank you.
Thank you, Gina, and eOption also for sponsoring this webinar today. And without further ado, we are going to move forward with this webinar. So, bearish option strategies, how to protect your stock positions in a bear market. That's what our topic of the day is today, and especially with the lay environment that we've had over the past few months, it's a very fitting topic for sure. So, real quick, we just want to show you the disclaimer from eOption. This is just to remind you that this webinar is for illustrative and educational purposes. So, and also I also put in my company disclaimer as well, same type of disclaimer. And with that, so real quick, the bio was that Gina gave you has told you about my background in trading and stuff, so we can skip through that. So right now, so you are a bear. So what do you do with that? So first you have to gauge your ability. Are you a beginner? Are you advanced? You know, what kind of rational expectations for the capital you have are you working with? You know, these are topics and ideas that you have to run through your head as you're figuring out which strategy you want to do. And one thing you can do is at eOptions, you have many tools that can help you develop these strategies if you haven't used them before through their Options Play platform. That's something that you can check out at their website. Now, one of the things you also want to think about is low volatility plays and high volatility plays. So what is the difference? When you have low volatility plays, buying may be better than selling. And then you have to think about what are your goals? What are you trying to achieve? These are the things that we're going to cover as we get through these different strategies over the course of this webinar. And especially like high volatility plays, selling is your friend, but you still have to always remember that one question. What are you trying to achieve? I mean, ultimately, we know making money is what all of us are trying to achieve no matter what you're doing with the markets. So as we cover these strategies, we're going to get into the intricacies as to how these actually play a very valuable role in making your decision on what you are going to do. So first of all, let me discuss real quickly the topics to be covered today. We're going to breeze through some beginner setups. I know there was a webinar just a couple weeks ago, I believe, by eOption, where they presented a bunch of basic option strategies. So we're only going to breeze through them, but I've been trading for, like Gina told you, for 30 years. I still use some of the most basic strategies all the time. It doesn't mean just because you're an advanced trader that you don't use these things. And also it depends on the market environment, why you may actually use those. So we'll discuss that as we go along. Also, what play is good for each individual? There's different levels of traders. There's also different level of capital that you have. You know, are you trading it? Are you just hedging your stock portfolio? These are things we will discuss. Then there's profit potentials and there's also loss potentials. And there is no holy grail in trading, no matter what anyone may say out there, because they can't, because there isn't. So, but there are always opportunities, and making sure that you can limit your loss, knowing your loss, is something that you have to be aware of when it comes to your money management, which we'll also discuss. the why of each option play. That's what we're going to also get into. Using implied volatility as an aid. Now, a lot of people have math anxiety. We are not going to get heavily into the Greeks. We are not going to get into a bunch of math to make things really difficult. We are going to, but when you get through this, you're going to have a visual representation where you actually are applying the Greeks in a way that makes sense for each different strategy. And then you can figure it out from there as we go along. So anyhow, time factors for and against you, we're going to cover that. That's a big part of option pricing. So, but once again, we're not going to get totally into the math, but we will explain how these strategies will work for and against you. And then making a play versus doing nothing. You know, one of the things I tell most people when they say, like, what should I invest in as a stock, or what kind of trading, or what are you looking at right now? You know, and I'm like, most of the times I tell people I'm looking what not to do, because that's really what you want to make sure you're definitely paying attention to. And sometimes there's a reason that you put something on and there's a reason why you don't. So we'll go over that too. Rational expectations is another thing that we're going to talk about. Have an actionable trading plan and also monitor your results. So with that, why be bearish on option strategies? Why would you do this? Well, there's many opportunities with varying advantages. There's also very versatile these strategies. You can control your risk for stock portfolio, for your positions that you have in your portfolio. And also your ability to profit off of bearish market movement also is something that you can gain by using these strategies. And then the controlled level of capital necessary. That's another thing that's also very important. And there's, that's why even though beginner strategies may not be something that, you know, think that's, it's kind of boring, but then you don't have to worry about margins. There's also different risk levels that are associated with these different strategies, and it'll all come clear as we get through them. So, disadvantages of bearish option strategies. There is, limited profit potential. There is a large selection of option plays, which can complicate picking a strategy for a situation, you know, so don't think that just because something, there are all kinds of different plays that you need to use all of them. You definitely don't want to use all of them. So each individual has a different need. So most strategies involve creating spreads, which equals higher commissions because of increased transactions. Now, this is where a broker like eOption comes into play, because they have very low commissions for options contracts. It tends cents a contract, that's absolutely next to nothing. So especially so if you're, and they also have the commission-free stock trading. So if you're buying your stocks and have your portfolio through there, you're already saving costs. And then if you use them for your option spreads, then you're also saving on your commissions and costs. Commissions are a part of your cost. That's a negative component, whether you are profiting or losing. So you always want to keep that as minimal as possible. And that's something you can control, which you can by obviously going through eOption. So beginner, you have to start somewhere, right? No one just starts out knowing everything. And then even still, what are the basics? So we're going to go over a couple quick strategies. The beginner bear plays. The covered call, that's where you own the stock, okay? And for all of these, the strategies that we're going to cover, we're assuming that you own the stock. So you own a block, so 100 shares. So that's what we're basing all these strategies off of. So in the covered call, that's where you sell a call at a strike price. And that strike price, we will get into where that's at. Protect a put, that's where you buy a put at a select strike price. We will get into where that pricing is as we get into the strategy. And then there's the collar, okay? That's where you own the stock and you're gonna buy a put at strike price A and you're gonna sell a call at strike price B. These are very simple strategies. You can also learn about these strategies on the eOption website, where they have a free option strategy guidebook which explains these in very good detail. So with that, let's get into our first strategy, the covered call. So you own the stock. So you sell a call at a strike price A. So the big question is right off the bat, why? So well, the reason is you are neutral to bullish, but do not mind selling the stock. So what does that mean? That means that you like the stock in your portfolio. It's a stock that whether the market is going up or it's going down, you find value in it. Maybe because it has a high dividend. Who knows what the underlying reason is for that, but it's something that you believe you want to hold in your portfolio over the long term. So why would you do the covered call? Well, you may be slightly bearish and you may wish to pad your short-term losses by using a covered call. Let's say you've had a nice run in the stock and then maybe that's what you would want to use. So, okay, let's get into the intricacies of this real quick before we get to a chart example. So one, you own the stock. Number two, you sell a call at strike price A. So typically the strike price is below strike price price A. So now you are bullish the stock long term, but are neutral to bearish in the short run. So you are willing to sell the stock if it reaches a specific level. Okay, so that's these are the factors that you initially have in your thought process as to why you would use a covered call. And when we get to the chart example, that's when we'll get to market environment and incorporate this into our strategies. So number one, our objective is keep the stock price as close to the strike price without going above it. And the call should be 30 to 45 days from expiration. Those are the where you get the maximum bang for your buck for this strategy. Okay, so now we're not going to get into the overall pricing of options because that in itself could be a webinar. So we're just take it at face value that for the different strike prices and the different months that are offered out there for any option or strategy that we're talking about, this one, 30 to 45 days, gives you the best value. So maximum profit, how does that value? Well, the strike price minus the stock price plus that premium for selling the call, that's where your maximum profit is, okay? So if the stock skyrockets, you'll miss out on those gains. So keep that in mind. Remember, nothing is perfect. So even though the covered call is something where it's like a little bit of an insurance, you're bullish, you like the stock long term, but in the short run, you're expecting a potential either neutral market or a lower trading market. So now if the market all of a sudden, you never know with the stock, sometimes there's breaking news that comes out, you've already got this position on and all of a sudden like there's a takeover for the stock and all of a sudden there's a big huge premium that explodes to the upside. That means your covered call, obviously you would lose, but you don't lose altogether. Your stock goes up, so you'll make that money, but you'll just be out that difference, which was the money you paid for you were out from the call. So now you have a break-even stock price also, okay? That's the premium that you received for selling the call, okay? So that's your break-even, and then your maximum loss is only if the stock goes down, then it's your premium minus the stock price, because obviously as the stock decays, and price, that you are going to be losing an asset value until as long as you hold that stock, and as long as you haven't executed a sell to exit the stock. So remember, it's like an insurance policy in the short run, but it doesn't just totally hedge yourself. So that's something that you have to take into account. Time decay is your friend in this position. Okay, so a drop in implied volatility also helps to lower the call value. Okay, so remember that when you're dealing with implied volatility, implied volatility goes up, option prices go down in price. As implied volatility goes down, the option prices go down. So there's a direct relationship to that. So if you especially are in an environment where you sell the call in a high volatility environment, and then all of a sudden it stabilizes, for instance, the stock stays neutral, and the more neutral it stays, the more likely implied volatility will also stay the same. These are factors that work on your side. So real quick, we're going to use IBM for all of our examples, and then you'll start to see as we evolve from the simple strategy to the complex. So if you look at this real quickly, you can see that there's an entry date. Now this webinar, we made these charts from the recent activity, and we all know about the fundamental coronavirus that has impacted the markets. We know that that caused a big sell-off during the last couple of months. So let's go back in time to when and why you would start to put on a bearish spread. So a simple fundamental is when markets are trending higher, you're doing what? You're consistently making higher move highs and higher move lows. So all of a sudden what happened back in February with IBM, after making a higher move high in the beginning of February, the market fell through and took out this last supported swing low that it made at the end of January. So that all of a sudden put the market into a neutral guideline. So let's say that you have IBM. When we're going to use IBM, it could be any stock in your portfolio, but this would be a scenario where you start to use bearish strategies. So on this day, you can see where the market had settled. It's right around $130. This is after the market had just been just below $160. This was a big slide that had occurred when the stock market started to sell off. Now, because of those fundamentals where you all of a sudden, you know, you never want to try and pick a top or a bottom when it comes to the stock market. But however, when we had a crisis like we recently are going through still, that's a point where you know that there was a most likely there would be a downturn in the market, at least, or the market would be suppressed. So this is a good time to start using these strategies. So which call would you use? Well, here's what you kind of like get your guidelines. So the market we started out with, the market's at 130 as far as its stock price, where it settled. And you want to know the next day, what options should I sell? Well, here's what you start to look at. One, we know that the option has to be above the market. So the closest strike price above the market would be the 135 strike and the 140 strike. Obviously, the 140 strike would be cheaper than the lower strike price. Now, which one would you use? Well, here's a good way of thinking about what you would think when which one to execute on. Remember, the time frame is 30 to 45 days out. You're still neutral to bearish, okay? So high volatility at this, or implied volatility at this time was very, very high. So that means you had a bonus of implied volatility. You have the bearish conditions, and either one, there's just a matter of which risk level you want to take. So now remember that when the stock price goes down, you'll make money off of the covered call, but it doesn't necessarily make up the difference of how steep the stock price goes down. That's why we use some of the other strategies which we get into, okay? So for one last thing is here, here was our level from the swing low. This is going to be our baseline that we're going to use for strike prices. Because remember, where support all of a sudden fails, then it usually becomes resistance, which it actually did here. So it's easy in hindsight to say that. But when we were looking for the trade example, we wanted to give you the pricing to make it stick out. So okay, that's our covered call. So now here's another strategy for beginners, and that would be to use a protective put. Okay, so you buy the put at a strike price and you already own the stock. Why, once again, would you want to use this strategy? Well, you are neutral to bullish. Same thing, well, this is where you're neutral to bullish. However, you're worried about that the implied volatility is going to increase, kind of like what has been going on, you know, obviously over the past couple months. And then there may be a short downturn. So especially like, let's say with IBM, you're like, okay, even if the economy gets into a downturn and the stock market goes into a downturn, IBM is a viable company that is heavily entrenched in the technology sector and the cloud and blah, 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 all kinds of reason where even Big Blue is something that nobody really talks about anymore. It still is one of the biggest technology companies in the world. So then you would say, why you want to be short-term, you're bullish or bullish in the long-term. So usually after you've had a nice run-up on the stock, that's where you'd have this protective put. Now remember our example, and we'll get to that chart after we just cover these intricacies. So just to be clear, remember you own the stock, you're buying a put at a strike price A, which is typically a stock price that will be, or the stock price will be above that strike price. So now you are bullish to stock long term, but now you are very worried. So remember the coronavirus variable, you know that you just took out a swing low. So in our situation of that day, what strategy would you use? A covered call. That's a great idea. Now we have a protective put. This is another way of playing that same trade. So you want the stock to go up strong and the puts to expire worthless. That's really what you want in this strategy. Ultimately, you want your stock to be worth more. But if not, you will profit on the put if there is a downturn in the stock, but you will lose stock value. But remember, if our premise for the stock is it's a stock that you want to hold in your portfolio, and ultimately you want to own it if you could. The question is, how can you manage owning that stock while still getting dividends and not having to take as much pressure and stress during any type of downturns in stock value? So the maximum profit theoretically is unlimited if the stock goes up. Okay, because then obviously if it keeps going up and keeps going up, you never know, it could split and keep going and be a bull for years. So that is a value that is, you know, potentially, you know, unlimited. The maximum loss is your stock price minus the stock price plus the premium paid for the stock. Okay, so this is where you have your premium. You got to remember you have a stock value that you start with. Okay. So when you buy the put, that basically raises the average cost of your stock price. So then if the stock price goes down, you're losing more than you, you're down more money than you would had you never put on the strategy to begin with. In other words, or in the opposite case, you're making money where the stock totally appreciates and you're only out that little bit of a difference that you paid for the protective put. So the break-even price now, that's where the stock price plus the premium paid for the put. That's where we start your example. That's where the stock price has to elevate to cover that initial cost of paying for that put. So it raises, basically what it means is it raises your average cost for that stock whenever you put on a protective put strategy, okay? Now the good thing is there's no margin required after the option is purchased. So as we get into some option strategies, there's always strategies where you start to get leverage comes into play, and that's when you have to use margin. These are more advanced and intricate strategies, which we'll cover, but this is where we're starting out, where it's very basic. You don't have to worry about margin. That is not an issue. Time decay on this strategy, however, is the enemy because the option value decreases. Remember, in this strategy, you're buying the put option. So when you buy an option, time is always a negative variable, okay? Now, implied volatility is a double-edged sword. It can help if it's rising, but it hurts if implied volatility starts to decrease. So now we have our protective put. A protective put here would be below the stock price, and you would use 125 would be your first level. That would be the level you would use. And as you can see, the market deteriorated after this date. So the first you would have put on the trade, and for a couple of days, the market was hanging. Remember, you have this for a 30 to 45 day expiration, and within just a couple of weeks, you can see how the market had decayed. You were obviously losing money on the stock price, but here's the difference though. When you buy the put, all of a sudden this $125 strike price, that becomes valuable. So now you're making money on the put. It cancels out the money that you're losing on your stock price. So you're putting in basically a hedge where you're only doubt out the difference of that where you first initially got into the stock price plus the premium you paid for the option, but then you have a new value because your option price is going up because the market has gone much lower. So had you then executed either the put, or you would have sold the put out later, you would have helped to pad your loss for the IBM stock. Now here's the question, the collar. Here's another simple one. You own the stock. Now here you're going to buy a put at a strike price A, and you're going to sell a call at a strike price B. Why? Well, you are neutral to bullish and do not mind selling the stock if you ultimately have to. You are bearish in the short run and looking to capitalize on both the short-term call and the long-term put. Basically, it's like having both of the first two examples. So real quickly, you can own the stock, you're going to buy a put at strike price A, and you're going to sell a call at strike price B. Typically, the stock price is between these two strikes, A and B. Now, remember, you are bullish to stock, but you are very worried. So that would be like in the coronavirus issue where the market, you've been up in IBM and you had made lots of profits on your trade. Who knows how long you've owned it, especially if it's something you've had for years. And now you're in a situation where you start to get worried. This is where the collar comes in. This limits both your downside and upside risk potential. Usually investors use this to protect unrealized profits from a downturn. So this is like having the covered call, which we first covered, and the protective put in the last example at the same time. So what's your break even? Well, that is your stock price minus your net credit or of the stock price plus the net debit, okay? So that means that, remember, you are buying a put and you're selling a call. So the difference in whether you have a credit or a debit for that spread will be indicative of how your break-even price is. Because if you have a credit, obviously that lowers your stock price average, or raises in the opposite for as far as where your break-even price is. Now, as far as maximum profit, where is that? Well, that's strike price B minus your current stock price minus your net debit paid or your credit received. Okay, so we'll cover that when we get to the visual example. This will make sense. For your maximum loss, your current stock price minus your strike price A plus the net debit paid or the net credit received. Remember, depending on when you put this position on and depending on whether you had high or low volatility, will be indicative of whether you're between buying the put and selling the call, whether or not you had a net debit or a credit. Now, here's the good thing is, you're selling an option here, but you don't need any margin after purchasing the option since the call is covered. So that's a good thing. So now you're getting into a more complex strategy because you're using two basic ones, but you still don't have to worry about margin, which is a very good thing. Now you do have time decay is neutral on this because since you bought an option and you sold an option, time really doesn't count. Irony of it all, it neutralizes it. Implied volatility also is, once the position is on, no longer becomes a factor. So those are two things in option pricing that no longer have anything to do with this spread. So now let's see what happens. So in this example, what happened? You sold the call at 135 strike price, okay? Now, when you did that, the market was trading at 130. Now you bought the 125 put strike price. Now, irony of it all, look what happened. You put on a strategy like this, unlike the other ones where you had only basically a one-way scenario to capitalize this market. The strategy, the market goes lower. As you can see, it broke down into March. Now what happens? That means that the call that you sold at 135, that strike price, that money, that's a plus. You're not out that money. That money, that credit that you took in, that is your money. You don't have to worry about it. Now here's the bonus. That put that you bought at 125, now all of a sudden that put is worth money also. So you make money on both options, both ways after you put the trade on. Now this is because the market had broken, obviously. Had it rallied, it would be a different scenario. However, your risk would be limited, and we know it would be where your work would be capped at. So in a situation like this, we're looking at the same market, the same entry day, and these different scenarios. Now let's get to where you really want to see the experienced traders. What are you going to do? Time to take things up a notch. All right, well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to cover four very nice strategies for experienced bear plays, and I think you're going to like what we're going to talk about here. So the very first one that we're going to talk about here is the long put strategy. So now for the long put strategy, you own the stock, and then you're going to sell a put at strike price A, and you're going to buy a put at strike price B. Why would you do such a thing? So, well, in this case, you are bearish, okay? Risk is limited by implied volatility and market movement. Time is neutral. So this is where, as we get into these more advanced strategies, certain variables that you hear all the time, like implied volatility and also, you know, like we said, the market movement, these things can be minimized and mitigated in certain ways. And then you're playing a certain variable on its own. So now let's go and look at this long put spread example. Okay, so in this example, you own the stock, okay? So then you're going to sell a put at strike price A, and then you're going to buy a put at strike price B. Now, when you do that, your stock price is below strike price B and above strike price A, okay? So now when you do this, the reason you put on this strategy is you are bearish and also have a downside target objective. So this is good when implied volatility is high. So like earnings season or the coronavirus event. Now here's another thing. Remember when we had the beginner options? This strategy as well is something you want to use only 30 to 45 days from expiration. And one of the reasons why I stress this is not just like my opinion. This is a fact because once you get beyond 45 days, or if you bought something that's below that, that's where time and implied volatility, they function on different ways. And I'm not going to get into the Greeks because once again, like I said in the beginning, that would be a whole webinar in itself. So we're giving you the best time frame scenarios for these spreads to capitalize on when you implement them. So this is not an opinion thing, this is a math thing. So, but we're just not going to get in, break it down for that. But if you want to know how to get into that stuff, there's all kinds of information on the eOptions website and stuff like that. And from the trading platform, you can access all kinds of ways of gauging how the implied volatility and these things work and how, when you want to execute your trades and how they'll be impacted. So, but like you said, you have to go to their website to look that up. Okay, so now let's get into the meat and potatoes of this. Break even, strike price B minus the net debit paid. So now remember, you're selling a put and you're buying a put, okay? So now there is going to be a net debit for this one, okay? So this is a long put spread example, okay? So now when you put this out, your maximum profit is your difference between strike price A and strike price B minus the net debit paid, okay? Then your maximum loss is your net debit paid. That's so if this position goes the wrong way, the only thing that you can lose on this position is your net debit paid. Okay. Now, another thing is that there is no margin needed after the cost of this spread. Remember, you're selling an option here, but then you're also buying an option. Okay. So that's a spread. Those cover each other. So you don't have to worry about any type of margin. Okay. Now, time decay is neutral. Remember that when you time works against you, when you are buying options, when you are selling options, it works for you. And since you are selling an option and buying an option, this neutralizes that effect. So time does not matter, but the 30 to 45 days from expiration when you put the spread on, that does matter. So don't worry about time decay as far as a factor once the spread is on. That has nothing to do with anything. Now, implied volatility dropping does help if your stock is going lower. Okay, so now remember, these are bear market situations. So most of these spreads, they're either a way of gaining a little bit of positive interest while you're taking heat on your position and you're losing stock value, okay? Or it's a way of hedging on the direction, okay? So now in this case, it hurts if the stock goes up. Okay, if the stock goes up, you want implied volatility to rise. That would be the only thing that can help you out with this in this scenario. Okay, so now let's real quickly, this is where things get a little complicated for those of you out there that are not advanced options traders. Implied volatility dropping helps if your stock is going lower. Okay, so if this you put on the long put spread example, and when you have your stock position on, you execute this strategy, that will work in your favor. Okay, now but it hurts if your stock price goes up. So now if all of a sudden that you own the stock, so that value, that is good. And remember, the only thing you can lose is the net debit paid. So what you're basically doing then is raising your average cost of your stock, or you're lowering your average price getting out when you do, if you were to execute, to get out of the stock at the same time, you'd be lowering your actual true execution price because you have the debit that you had paid. So that's where that will take out a little bit of your profit in that case scenario. But you still would be making money on the bullish moves. You would only be trimming a little bit of your profits if the market goes up. Okay, so now let's look at the chart. So let's look at our example here. Remember, this is all the same entry day. Okay, so we have the long put spread. This is where you buy the 135 strike price. And remember, that's right at our pivot point that we used that because that was a prior swing low and support, where there is support. When the market goes below it, then usually that becomes resistance, just like the opposite, resistance becomes support. These are just basic fundamentals. So we're playing off that scenario and also the coronavirus fears and the big market sell-off. That's why, remember, we're using these strategies. So you buy the 135 put. Remember, your stock price is right around at 130 where it's trading. And then you're going to sell the 125 put strike A. So now in this is going to be a net debit for this, especially because look at where you're so close to the strike price for the call, or for the put price, for the strike price B, because on the second entry day there, when you get into it, you can see how the market goes up into there. So your premium would be higher for this option here. So your net debit for this would then be, that's your cost. And that would be the most you could lose. Because remember, let's say that this market never did go back down and actually rallied and went back up to make new highs at $160. Well, then you'd be up back up money in IBM, and you'd only be out that premium that you had paid for the debit for that spread. But that's it. You know your risk is defined. And that's something else you got to remember, especially the more advanced strategies that you use out there, always have defined risk. That's one thing I can say from my experience. If you want to know what helps to give you a future, not to mention just give you a chance, is that you have to always define your risk and be disciplined with that. I know plenty of people that had very large capital behind them, and it all disappeared just because of that variable loan was one of the biggest things. That lack of discipline and defining risk meant that they were always taking trades where they just should never have taken it. You want to always have a good reward to risk ratio. You never want to risk more. That's a whole nother webinar in itself, money management. But these are things that you definitely need to consider. So now this one here, obviously the market went down. And so look at how this position ended up working out. So on the entry day, you were at 130. A month later, now the irony is today as we're talking, the market's actually $15 lower. So had you put this on back at the end of February and ridden this spread all the way out, here's what would have happened. You bought the 135 put strike price B. That would have been a winner. You would have made money off of that option. Then you have your selling 125 put strike here. What happens here? The market's below there. So that means in this case, you know, you sold a 125 put. This is where now when the market goes lower, you know, you have the issue where you can get exercised on. So whether you do what you do here is, remember, you don't mind selling the stock. Remember, you can always get into the stock. So now, depending how long you held this, that would have been indicative of what you would have done as far as whether you would have liquidated your option spread and the stock, or whether you would have held it and then been executed on. But remember, here's the thing, is that who cares if you sold a 125 put strike, because you own a 135 put. So look at that. It doesn't matter. This one here is not a negative. It doesn't come back to haunt you. So that's why these strategies define your risk. It keeps you very, it keeps you focused. You know exactly where you're at. Now, this is different than just doing a covered call. Okay. It's a big difference. You know, there's a whole dichotomy between these trades where it's a good environment to do it. There's nothing wrong with those first couple of spreads strategies that we use. This is a little bit more of an advanced strategy. And this is one where I think it's definitely for people that have been taking action in the option environment for a while. If you haven't been trading for, I would say, at least five years or more, or trading heavily, I wouldn't suggest starting to get into these spreads. I was looking more at the first ones that we had talked about, or a couple of the ones that are coming up. So now let's go and look at the short call spread. Here, this is where you own the stock. You sell a call at strike price A and you buy a call at strike price B. So why? You are bearish with high implied volatility and you wish to cap your risk. So once again, you own the stock. You sell a call at strike price A. You buy a call at strike price B. The stock price is usually below strike price A. Okay. You are bearish, but neutral conditions are all right. Ultimately, you want both options to expire worthless. If A is one standard deviation out of the money, this will increase the probability of success. Now, that's something that we're not going to get into the total math of that, but just to let you know, just that one factor will help you out with this position. And once again, this is a position where you use 30 to 45 day out options. So your break even price is strike price A plus the net credit received. Now, this one is a spread where you get a credit. Now, I love credit spreads. Now, credit spreads, whether you're bullish or bearish, this has been my experience, and both in equity trading and futures trading, I use these strategies. Okay. When it comes to credit spreads, I love them. You have to get the good pricing, and it depends on what your volatility is. And we'll kind of get into that as we get through this example. So break even, once again, is strike A plus the net credit received. Your maximum profit is your net credit received at opening of the position. So after that, this position only goes down in value, but that's what you want, especially if you buy it back or if you let it go to expiration. Now, your maximum loss is the difference between the strike price A and strike price B minus the net credit received. And we'll show you that when we get into the chart example. Okay. So now the margin is the difference between the two strike prices. Okay. So now this is the first time when we have an issue where margin kind of comes into play, but not really. It's still basically kind of neutral. Time decay in this position is slightly positive. Now, remember, through these other examples we were talking about, whether you sell or whether you buy the options, it kind of wipes out the time decay variable. Not in the case of this one. And we'll get into that. Now, the reason time decay is slightly positive is because this is a credit spread. So right off the bat, you are taking in the option pricing when you start the position. The time value, no matter what, is going to decrease right after you put on that strategy. So that will always be going in your favor. Okay. So that is slightly positive. Okay. Just because of the fact that it is a credit spread. Now, the opposite would be if it's a debit spread. Okay. So implied volatility dropping helps if your stock goes down. Now, remember, you want the stock to go down in this scenario. Okay. Now, implied volatility dropping helps because obviously, as implied volatility drops, that also helps to reduce the price of the spread. Remember, you took in a credit. So even if you were to get by the spread back, if you have time, a couple days of time decay, which helps you out, and then if volatility starts to drop, so even if you executed this strategy and then a couple days later got out of it and the market hadn't really moved, you would most likely realize a profit just because of a drop in implied volatility and time decay. That's without any market moving. And then if the stock actually went down just a little bit, well, then for sure you would be seeing a profit on your spread. So that's a nice advantage to the short call spread. Like I said, credit spreads are a really big favorite of mine for my trading war chest. And I'll get into some examples of that once we get through into the next slide. Now remember, implied volatility dropping helps if the stock goes down, but not if the stock goes up. Because remember, if the stock goes up, then it starts to go through your spread, and your gain on the stock would not be as much because you'd have to give up the credit. And we'll get into how that works on when we get to the example here on the chart. So rising implied volatility will help if the stock price does go up, though. Okay, because remember, since it's a credit spread, if the price of the stock goes up, the credit spread, even though certain pricing values go down, implied volatility will work in your favor. So that's where if this position was to go against you, it actually wouldn't be as severe. Okay, now let's see what happens with this. So remember, this is where you're buying and selling two different strike prices. And usually the strike is right around or right in the middle here. So here we have the market was right at 130. So we sell the 130 call strike price. Okay. And then we buy a 135 call strike price. Now, here's the thing is a 135 call, since it's above the market, whether that's going to be at a cheaper price than one that is at the market. Okay. So this is where you're buying this. And when you sell this 130 call, that has more value. So that's where your credit comes in. Okay, so the only thing here that you know is that your risk is if the market goes up. But then what happens? Your risk is only the credit that you took in minus what you pay getting out of that spread, because you can only lose the difference between $1.35 and $1.30 minus the credit that you earn plus the credit that you already paid. So that would be your risk. So your risk is totally defined on this trade, which is fantastic. Now here's the beautiful thing about this. This market traded lower. We know we're using the same chart, same entry day, stock for our examples. So what happens in this situation? The market eroded. So you're buying the 135 call strike price. You know that call went worthless. Okay. And then you're selling the 130 call up here. Well, that one obviously expires a winner. So your credit right there, that's good. So that was a little bit of a padding to your losses on your stock. Now remember, this started at 130, the market got all the way down to almost $90 a share. Now in this example here, it got back to 117, which ironically is where it's trading at right about right now. Actually, I think it's at 115 today. So, and in this example, so that you would see that you would still be down right now $15 of value. However, you would have that credit plus any dividends paid. Now, I don't know if there was any dividend paid or anything like that. I don't think there was for IDM, but at least you know that you were in a situation where now you would still be down, what is it, $13 on the stock, but you would be actually down less than $13 because you have a positive credit that you made from the option spread. So once again, this is a credit spread, short call spread, one of my favorites. Now let's look at the long straddle. Okay, you own the stock, you buy a call strike at price A, you sell a put at strike price A. Why? Volatility is increasing and you are expecting large market swings. Well, this is great for the examples that we've been getting at, because guess what? Who cares if the market goes up or down? All it's got to do is it's got to move. You know that right now, you're looking at where the market has been, where you're at right now, and you most likely you're looking for volatility to drive the price of the stock away from where it's at. You're unclear. Like right now, you own a good stock like IBM, but then you have the coronavirus fundamental that's pounding the stock market. But then IBM comes out with great earnings and lifts for whatever reason. These scenarios have you spinning. What do you do? Here you go. You have a long straddle example. So once again, you own the stock. You buy a call at strike price A. You buy a put at strike price A. The stock price is at or near stock price A. So now what is the whole reason? Once again, you are anticipating a move in the stock price, but you are unclear which way it will move. Like I said, it doesn't matter. You don't even have to care. You just think that you are definitely in a position where you think volatility is going to move, and whether it's bearish or bullish, something's going to happen. So this will boost your profits to the upside and a large bearish move will offset your losses in on the stock price. So this is something where, remember, you like IBM. Over the long haul, you want to own Big Blue, but you don't know what's going to go on with this, with the current market conditions. You want to be able to somehow ride the storm and at least protect your assets and at least have some sort of income coming in for your investment while you have a downturn, if you have a downturn. So what happens? Break even is either strike price A plus the net debit paid for strike price A minus the net debit paid. Okay, so what does that mean? Remember, you're buying a call and a put at the same price. So you are paying a debit for this trade. So when the strike, when the stock price moves, whatever that debit is, that is wherever, if this, our example is at 130 for the stock price of IBM. So whatever, let's say you paid a net debit of $8. Okay. So then you know that that has to move X amount. So it'd be 138. Okay. We're just using that as a blind number right now. So that would be where you guide your break even. So your maximum loss is your net debit paid. So the most you can lose on this position is on the option spread is what you paid for the spread. You can't lose, since you're buying these options, you can't lose any more than you paid for it. That's the one thing that's nice about buying options. Now your maximum profit, okay, to the upside, it's unlimited to the upside. Minus the debit paid. Remember, you paid for the spread. So the market has to move at least the price paid for the spread above the stock price for you to start to see a profit. But remember, let's say all of a sudden this IBM went to new highs, went back up to 160. So you would make all that money, plus you'd make money on your call, minus the price you paid on your put. And we'll get into the example when we get to the chart. Now, no margin is necessary after spread is purchased. Time decay works against you on this trade. Implied volatility helps if it goes up and hurts if it goes down. Okay, so for the long straddle, you buy the 130 call strike A, you buy the 130 put strike B. What happens? Well, okay, we know what happened. The market broke severely. So on this trade, let's say that you had followed directions. You did the 30 to 45 days out, as we've been talking about for these strategies. So as the market had gotten down, especially towards this $90 or $100 level, or even now, you would still be up on these spreads, or by now you actually would have rolled out of the spread. So where would you make your money? Well, you buy the 130 call strike. Obviously, you don't make any money on that. But on the put, that's where you make your money. And the best part about it is this is spread is right at the strike at the stock price or really close to it. So since the market was trading at 130 or just above 130, that means anything below the strike price of 130, your put was kicking into gear. So that means you made money on this whole way down. And that's the way you covered. Remember, if you have a covered call, you only make the money that you took in as a credit for selling a call. That was the first example we started this webinar with. Now in this example, boom, you have the call and the put on both sides of the market. And when you actually have a move, and it actually didn't know whether it was going up or down, but guess what? It broke. And even right now, that would be still up money on your position. So your loss on your stock position would be covered by that. So that has a tremendous amount of power to influence what's going on with your stock portfolio and how you manage the risk with that and covering it with a bearish strategy. So remember, I like those credit spread examples. I also love the straddle example. Now, here's another example, the long strangle. Strangle is very, very similar. You own the stock, you buy a put at strike price A, and you buy a call at strike price B. So they're not the same strike price. Now, why? Implied volatility is rising and a big move is expected. So basically, you're looking at the same thing as the last example. Now, here's the thing is, like I said, once again, you own the stock, you buy the put strike price A, which will be below the strike price, you buy a call at strike price B, which will be above the strike price or the stock price, okay? Now, this is similar to the straddle once again. You are anticipating a move in the stock price, but you are unclear which way it will move. This will boost your profits to the upside and a large bearish move will offset your losses in the stock price. And we'll cover that once we get to the chart. Your break even, this basically is the same formula as we had for the other example for the straddle. The only difference is that you are not using the same strike price. There's a gap between them. Okay, so the equation is the same as for the last last one, except for the fact that obviously the pricing is different because you're using two different strike prices. Your maximum profit is limited to the upside minus the debit pay, the same as the last example, and the same as the downside where it's your it's just your debit paid, and also that limits that cuts your profit potential. Your maximum loss is always just like the last one, your net debit paid. Your margin on this is not needed after the spread is purchased. Decreased implied volatility does hurt this spread, and rising implied volatility helps this spread. So it is same as the last one. So now here we have the IBM once again, the same example. Now remember, we were trading right around 130 for this position when this all these strategies are being used for. Now we have the buy the 135 call strike price above the market and buy the 130 put strike price right at the market, basically. So it's just slightly below where the market was trading. And once again, what happened, the market decayed. And just like in the straddle example, your put kicks into gear right away. And the only thing that you're not realizing that takes away from your profit potential from this put is the price that you paid for the spread for buying the 135 call and also buying the 135 put. Okay, so with that being said, what you need to remember always with all these strategies is the impact of time. Time affects these strategies differently. Remember, you can go onto the eOption website and you can download their free option strategy guidebook, and it will give you all kinds of information on how to learn about the time and different variables for the strategies. Now, also maximum profit and loss. Remember, this is something you always have to take into account and be mindful of. Remember, there's a big difference between the covered call strategy and the straddle strategies that we just talked about. I like the straddles and strangles a lot, especially for this kind of environment. But once again, you got to be experienced with what you're doing. You got to learn how to walk before you crawl. And just remember always your expectations, they're going to be different. You know, what you get for a covered call is not what you get for a straddle and vice versa. And then implied volatility. Remember, implied volatility impacts option pricing. That's one of the things you don't have to follow all the Greeks to know, but you definitely have to follow implied volatility and have a clue whether it's going up or down based off of which strategy you're going to do. Because remember, if implied volatility going up is good for your position, then that's one to take. If it works against you and you think volatility is going up, well, then don't do it, right? So with that being said, I want to thank you very much before we get to the questions. I wrote a book called High Probable Japanese Candlestick Patterns that Gina mentioned. And there's a whole section on bearish patterns and when you can go short the market or get out of positions. In this case, since you were holding a stock position, you want to hold that stock, but you want to put on a bearish strategy. So sometimes you don't know you're in an upward trend, you're still very strong in your opinion of the stock, but you think that, well, every once in a while I need to know when to cover myself. Well, when you have a bearish pattern that sets up, that gives you a timing situation where you're like, oh, maybe now is the time to put on a cover call, or maybe now is the time to put on a straddle or a strangle. Let's say you're riding IBM and it's been rallying for the past 2 months and you're up on all-time highs. Every once in a while, it might be a time to put on a straddle situation, and who knows, you find the pattern, all of a sudden it occurs, you put on that strategy, and then you see what happens. So with that, let's get to some questions that we have had here. So let's see, we have had a couple of questions. One of the most interesting questions are, what are some strategies to take advantage of low interest rate environment? Well, in a low interest rate environment, ironically, using high income ETFs, trading those and using options on them is definitely a great idea. One of the things that's nice about eOption is your stock and ETF trades are all commission free. So if you are trading ETFs in this low interest rate environment with high volatility and then putting on options positions, which are also you're putting on at a very low cost, I would say that would be a great start. Now also with the low interest rate environment, here's what you have to take into account. Because the interest rates are low, interest rates are a function of option pricing. So if interest rates go up, then the price of calls will tend to, that pricing will start to go up and the pricing of puts will go down. Whereas right now it's the opposite, where call prices are down and put prices are high. Okay, so interest rates do have a factor when it comes to options pricing. We could spend a whole webinar on interest rates. I started trading the treasury bonds 30 years ago. In fact, that one of the first markets I started trading was the bonds. And watching interest rates is something that I've done for my whole career. Okay, so let's see. How can an investor use options to navigate wild volatility? Okay, well, wild volatility, once again, we talked about our straddle and strangle example. That would be where you could definitely manage volatility in a great way. Also the credit spreads. Now here's another thing. Let's say that your straddle and strangle is an idea that you like. And then here's another idea. You can do credit spreads the same way. You know, where if, for instance, if you're bearish, you'll sell call spreads. So I see we have Cecil Chang raised their hand. I don't know what the question is, so I'm working off of these. Maybe they'll get it to me somehow. How can your investors, okay, so let's see, what are the most important lessons you've learned being a professional trader? I would say, first of all, one, you have to have a plan. Number two, you have to be disciplined about sticking to a plan always, no matter what. You do not waver from it. When you don't just willy-nilly put on a trade and then figure out what to do with it, you should have an actionable reason why you're putting on a trade. Also, risk management. You should have rational expectations. One of the biggest things I've encountered, and this can definitely get into where we've talked about strategies where you own the stock already. So you have that value in your portfolio, and then you're looking at it as a way to manage your risk with that stock. So that's a way of hedging or, curtailing potential losses while we're holding that position. Now, when you are not doing that, you know, there's other options, trading strategies you can use where you don't own the stock. So then you start to increase your risk level. So then you definitely need to have not only just a strategy in place, but be very mindful of your risk. Remember that if let's say you start out whatever your balance is and you're down, say 5 to 6% on your trading account, you need to make like 15 to 17% to come back to even to become profitable after commissions. I finally got the questions here. It's showing, what are some key pointers to determine when to use strangle and straddle? Okay, key points for that is the volatility. For instance, whether it was even now, right now, where we're at in this market environment, it was funny because we've had a nice bounce in the stock market. And we were talking about first when we were coming up with this webinar and producing it, it was like, okay, well, let's take advantage of the current environment. We'll do this bearish strategies webinar. Now here, it's like, we're like, oh my gosh, the market's been bouncing for the past 2 weeks, 3 weeks, what do we do? Well, this is when you use straddles and strangles. You have no idea about market direction. You expect a move, you expect volatility. Like, nobody expects the stock market pretty much to stay stagnant over the next few months as we come off of the effects of the coronavirus fundamental. And then we have earnings season, which we have had a tremendous turnout in certain companies where they beat expectations and they were a surprise. But we have this potential tidal wave of businesses that are closing potentially over the next 6 months. So this is where when you're trading, especially like the stock indexes or major stocks, for instance, put on a straddle or a strangle. Here's another one. You have a raging bull like Amazon that, it took a beating in the first month of the stock market sell-off. And then within literally weeks, it's like back to all-time highs, and this is something where you can, as a options trader, straddles and strangles, buying options now is something where volatility works with you. I can give you an example, like the dot-com era of the 90s was when I first started really trading equity options. And I still to this day tell people, I'm like, I can't believe how it was like having an ATM every single day when you had stocks like Qualcomm, AOL, that these stocks were trading $30, $40, $50 away from where they opened up. So you could literally buy straddles and strangles on the opening and then sell them an hour or two before the close, just like 5 hours later. And like, you would make money every single day almost. And because not only did you get the market movement, but there's next to no time decay because you're only talking about a couple hours. The only edge you were really losing was between the bid and offer from not being on the floor, because I was working on a trade on a futures pit. So my equity options were being traded over the phone, which believe it or not, my first equity account was at Regal Discount Securities years ago, back in the day. So, which is now obviously Regal Securities and e-options. So let's see. Also, what data points should I use to determine the best strike price? Okay, what is the best data points to determine the best strike prices for straddles and strangles? Okay, well, for straddles, obviously you want to be as close to the strike price as possible. with a strangle, obviously you're going around it. Okay. So with that being said, you can find some, it's not too far away from the strike price, but I would usually try and go, like, especially like in this situation where you're looking for, most likely you're in a bearish market, like after you've made a significantly higher move high, you're making newer move lows, then that would be where I'd try and have the stock price be already be above the straddle and the strangle. Okay. So it gives you probably a little bit more edge. So if you're buying into a correction or placing the spread into a correction, that gives you a little bit more vig to the upside. And if you're right that the bearish movement continues, you're already leaning on the offer. So that's kind of how I would look at it for the best pricing on eyeballing it. See, the other thing is too, is you have to look at when you're on the, when you're executing the trade, is what is your pricing? See, sometimes there's discrepancies where, like I said, I would pick this one scenario, but if the pricing tells me the other option price is, like, for instance, if I am in this case, I'd be buying. So if I can buy one straddle at a cheaper price than the other one, and it's, I'm expecting the same market movement, I may actually be able to capitalize a little bit more on that. So that's hard for me to give you a direct answer without knowing the pricing at the moment you're putting on the trade. So there's a couple variables you'd have to eyeball on that, but otherwise I go back with, like I said, have the market above the straddle point or strangle point for that. Being said, and let's see. How does an investor stay calm in the markets? What strategy do you use to stay unemotional? To stay unemotional, that's something I just became numb to a long time ago. So that's a little bit harder of a question to ask on how to stay unemotional. You just don't get emotional anymore. As far as like what strategies to stay unemotional, like I love straddles and strangles for equity positions, just because of the fact that it's, you don't have to worry about direction. You're just looking for volatility to rise and the market to move. And if you are right on those two variables, and usually the market movement is really the only one you have to be right on, that's the way to go. When to use strangle or straddle? You mentioned implied volatility. Is there a recommended percentage to use on one or the other? No. For the straddles and strangles for implied volatility, remember that it's just a matter of defining your risk. A straddle and strangle are going to be a little bit different in price. So where you give up that difference because you're buying the options, that difference in price where the stock is in between those two strikes, the volatility is going to be the same for each position. That's not going to make a difference. So you wouldn't choose one over the other because the implied volatility is rising or lowering. And as far as a recommended percentage, it's not the percentage that matters. It's the implied direction. So when you're buying a straddle or strangle, you want implied volatility to be low. You're expecting implied volatility to go up. Remember, for a straddle or strangle, it's not the direction. It's the fact that you get market movement. And if you do get market movement, a large market movement implies what? The volatility will go up. So, and with that being said, I think that we are probably out of time with questions. And I think that Gina might want to come back on. I'm not sure.
Yes, thank you so much, Teddy. We're going to wrap it up now. That was very interesting and informative and quite a lot of information, and definitely gave our customers and the people on the webinar a lot of food for thought. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it. We had a few questions. Wanted to let you know the webinar is recorded and we will make it available in a couple of days on our website at eoption.com. Also, as Teddy mentioned, if you go to eoption.com, we do have a free option strategy book that you can download, as well as we do have an education tab on our website where we have hyperlinks to all of these strategies that Teddy talked about. So you can click on the strategy like a long strangle and it'll tell you when to use that strategy and points to think about and really get into specific details. So it's a great resource if you want to get a little more in depth in some of these strategies. Also, as Teddy mentioned, we do offer a tool called Options Play. It's an online trading tool and it's free to all eOption customers. And basically what that is that'll help you to set up the right options strategy or the right trade for you, depending on your strategy, if you want to sell a covered call, if you want to generate income. So if you haven't checked out Options Play, I suggest you look into it and go to eoption.com and check it out. We do have instructional videos that shows you step-by-step on how to use it and get started. And it's a great tool, whether you're a novice just starting in options or you're experienced, sophisticated investor. We find option traders of all levels find it particularly useful. And again, it is free for all eOption customers. And last, we do plan on having more webinars in the future like this. Teddy will come back and give more in the future. And if you like us on Facebook, you'll get advance notice of these webinars as well and get trading tips and market updates. So again, thank you so much for attending. We really appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing you in the future at another webinar. Thank you so much. Bye now.